What's up, Pirate Nation? I'm your host, David Iman, and welcome to a brand new edition of Hall Talk. And while March Madness is in full swing on the men's side, on a more personal note, it's just getting revved up on the women's side, as the Seton Hall women's basketball team will be playing in the NCAA tournament for the first time in 20 years. We'll have all that, as well as the state of the baseball team. This is Hall Talk.
This team needs to show me something for me to believe that they're going to make a run in the tournament.
I think they can have a chance of going over 35 wins without a problem.
Just stepping up from the 4 points to the 17, she's just dropping threes like there's no tomorrow.
But chemistry is an underrated key in college basketball.
That was by far the best game I've seen them play.
This is Hall Talk, and that's how the chalk talks.
Welcome back, and I am now joined alongside my panel for this evening, George Bilekci and Aaron Ross. Guys, in this very exciting time, thanks for joining me.
Thank you. We're all looking forward to Saturday night at 6:30 when the women's team finally tips off against Rutgers.
Couldn't say any better myself.
Before we dive into the women's team, we're going to tackle the baseball team. They've gotten their season underway, and just on Wednesday, they opened up their home opener against St. Peter's, and guys, 16-2, the offense exploded. They were behind starting pitcher freshman Anthony Pasillo, who went six strong. What do you have to say about him, George?
You look at what Pasillo's doing, and he's really come a long way since last season as well. And this team, what was more than just the pitching is taking on, is that the bats are finally awakening. When they started off 1-8 on the season, they were losing by a margin of an average of about 4 runs, only averaging about 2.7 runs a game. They've opened up on their 5-game win streak. They've never put up less than 11 runs. And like you said, they exploded on St. Peter's. 16-2 victory. It was their home opener this year as well. That's what you want from this team. And when the seniors and juniors are kicking off, Sherradio, right. Jenkins, Annunziato, Weigel, Ruhlman, that's what you really want to see. The bats are there to back up the pitchers. That's how baseball is played. They're getting back to the basics, and that's Shepherd baseball for the Pirates.
Exactly.
Back to basics.
You talk about the pitching being great, the bats finally getting going. You know, I think they might have been a little upset about, you know, that they started off the season against North Carolina, letting up 7 runs at least in all 3 of those games, getting swept, and they didn't get more than 4 runs in any of those games. And getting 16 yesterday, you got Zach Weigel going 3-for-4, getting 3 RBIs, and scoring 2 runs himself. DJ Ruhlman, who was Big East Player of the Week, batting 11-for-15 on the week. That's incredible. And then getting 3 RBIs, 2 runs in the same game. I don't know, the bat's just rolling.
Now we see in all levels of baseball, not just collegiate level, but in major leagues as well, you know, beginning of the season, teams start off slow. And with this team, like Aaron, you said, they did start off slow. But how much of a confidence booster does this have to be for the young guys to see this team, this offense, putting up 16 runs in just, you know, the first couple weeks of the season? And Coach Shepherd has to be pretty happy about that as well.
It's definitely huge, especially as, like, a young guy on the team. Like you say, you want to, like, you know, you have the slow start, you're a little upset, you're like, I don't know how the season's going to go. And then you just blow up, get 16 runs, only let up 2, and just absolutely annihilate another team. As a young guy, you're going to be like, all right, let's go. This season, we're on the right track now. I think good things are going to happen.
And what you have with this team, like Aaron mentioned, they opened up at UNC, at Virginia. Those are both top 10 teams in the nation. The best way to show how good you are is to expose yourself to the best competition possible. That's what Shepherd does every year. And it gets to a point where baseball, when you're 1-8, it gets frustrating. The little things aren't working for you.
It definitely does.
You're not making good contact on the balls. The fielding isn't happening for you. And the pitchers, they're not able to stay healthy and on the mound. When the little things start to pile up, that's when this game, that is one of the most pure games, one of the most pure sports there are, is so much fun. When you start winning again, getting the bats going, everyone starts hitting and everyone starts relaxing again, you don't have to worry as much about winning. You just worry more about what you have to do as an individual.
Right.
That's where the biggest break is for this team, especially the experience they have. This is one of the premier teams. Was in the Big East last season. They're one of the premier teams in the Big East this season again. Like we said, they opened up 1-8. Now they're on a 5-game winning streak, and it's just getting started. The weather's getting warm. They're starting to come home, play in front of their home crowd. That's what they want.
And we have seen what this team can do once they get rolling.
Oh, yeah.
Just the past couple years.
Exactly. So like when he mentions the weather problem, too. Once it starts getting warmer, too. Because it was a cold day when they were playing the other day.
Yeah, they had a couple games postponed here as well.
Yeah, exactly. Snow-covered field. Now the snow's gone. And it was chilly for that St. Peter's game. And they still get the bats rolling. Because it hurts when you hit the ball in the cold.
The big thing you look at on this game, they had 16 runs on 19 hits. That's right. Efficiency. Every guy on base, no one's left stranded. That's what you want as a team.
Right. Well, one of the first signs of spring is baseball being back, and we could not be happier to have Shoe Baseball back. From here, they will participate in the Strikeout Cancer Tournament starting tomorrow on Friday. They'll take on UConn at 4:30. On Saturday, they'll take on Fordham at 1 o'clock and UConn again at 4:30, and then they'll wrap up the tournament at 1 o'clock on Sunday against Fordham. So let's shift away from the diamond and onto the hard court. And guys, it has been quite the season for women's basketball. They're currently at 28-5. They finished the season 15-3 in the Big East. They were not able to win the Big East tournament. They lost to DePaul, but that's all right. They're in the NCAA tournament for the first time in 20 years. They learned that fate Monday night at the NCAA selection show party that they hosted in Walsh Gym. But there's a kick, because there always seems to be one in March. They're playing Rutgers. And how great is that for them to play the in-state rival? And not just, it's great when they play in the regular season, but now they're playing for all the marbles NCAA tournament. George?
And what's good with this is you have three premier teams from New Jersey, including Princeton as well. So you see the Garden State really showing all the talent they have on basketball. And it's better that last year they met in the WNIT tournament. They lost in overtime.
That. Yeah. I remember that.
And it was big. That was down in New Brunswick at Rutgers. And Seton Hall's not going to get an easy out. They have Kalia Cooper and Benasia Laney, both for Rutgers. And they're both over 6 foot, averaging about 15 points per game. And Laney, 11 rebounds a game. To me, what it's going to really come down to is what Tony Bazella, as he's done all season long, what he can get out of Chizoba Ekedigwe, Tiffany Jones, and Luberdia Gordon, who played a healthy amount of minutes in the Big East tournament. They really need to control the paint. They need to expose this Rutgers defense, and they need to hit their shots because it's going to be a battle down in the block with those two.
George, real quick, you bring up Tony Bazella. Aaron, you caught up with Coach Bazella Monday night at the party.
That I did.
At the NCAA tournament selection show party they had at Walsh. Here's Aaron with Coach Bazella.
Hey guys, I'm joined here with Coach Tony Bazella, the women's basketball team, Big East Coach of the Year. Now, Tony, this is an incredible year for you guys, making the tournament for the first time in a while. Your second year here, just your take on making the tournament in general here.
So exciting for the girls. They worked so hard. It was a dream when I took over this job just about 2 years ago. And I'm just so happy for them, just to see their reaction. I told them it's a night they'll never forget, and it's not I won't forget it. And I had my wife and my son right in front of me, my daughter on the team. It's just a great special moment. I'm happy for the staff. They've worked really hard, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, and it's definitely going to be memorable. And now you get to play Rutgers again, get some redemption from last year, that Sweet 16 battle in the NIT, double overtime. I mean, I saw that, and that was crazy heartbreaker just to get back at them down, and especially in Storrs.
Absolutely. You know, Storrs, the UConn fans are great fans, and hopefully they'll get behind us in this game. I love you, UConn fans, but it'll be great. You know, obviously I have so much respect for Rutgers. Coach Stringer and her staff are really great to me. They've been great people on the road. They have a great program, and we need this stuff, though, because we need the fans of New Jersey to see really good basketball, and you're going to have two great teams playing each other. I think it's really great.
Yeah. Now, have you done any scouting report, maybe any looking into the future at all?
You know, I've seen Rutgers play during the year, and I know they're very talented. They're much better than they were last year. As are we. You know, tonight we'll go home, watch some Rutgers tape, and we'll figure it out.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Coach Bell. There you have it, Big East Coach of the Year. Good luck along in the future right here in the tournament.
Thank
it's
you.
Be great.
You guys do a great job. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Aaron. That was great. And it's so nice to see Coach Bazella talk about this team and where he's taken them so far. I remember during that night on Monday, he said, 2 years ago when I first came in here, we all had one goal, talking in the back room about getting to the NCAA tournament. And exactly. Now that's realistic. Now that's happening. And that dream has been realized for Coach Bazella and his group. And Aaron, how great is that for a coach to come in 2 years later? We saw the state of this program just a couple years ago. To go from what it was to now in the NCAA tournament, how great is that for Coach Bazella and his team?
I mean, it's astonishing to see, because where they were just 2 years ago before he was here, we had the likes of UConn and Notre Dame, top-level teams in the conference, and they were beating us by 50 points. Like, no one wanted to even be there. The Walsh Gym probably had 30 people in the building. Now that Bazella's there, when he even said, like you said, at the thing, saying, we're going to make the NCAA tournament in the next 2 years. And everyone's thinking, that's nonsense. I don't think you have a chance. And they go out there, make a statement this year, and they just ran the Big East table, beating everyone. It's what you want as a team. As a coach 2 years in, that's really great.
Very impressive. And that's been a huge storyline here in South Orange is the Tony Bazella era. George, another storyline with this team this year, if you remember guys back in September, was Daisha Simmons. She started her career at Rutgers and transferred to Alabama. And then we remember the whole storyline of her wanting to transfer here for grad school to be with her ailing family. It's amazing. This now comes full circle. She plays Rutgers in the NCAA tournament. George, just comment. how her entire career sort of comes full circle now for Daisha Simmons.
It's great because you see all conferences that she's participated in, all of a sudden this season being contended. I mean, she played Georgia of the SEC, of course, where they'd feed him at Walsh. And you're right, you talk about the coaches. And you think about the two great coaches she played for in the NCAA, Vivian Stringer of Rutgers, who's a Hall of Famer, and Tony Bazella, who's on his way up because he's not leaving anywhere. This is always, like he says, his dream job. And what I love is the defensive presence that Daisha brings, because at Seton Hall, they love to play full court offense. They like to first force the turnovers, pull down defensive rebounds, and get running. Rutgers does the same thing. They force about 19 turnovers a game. Daisha's going to play a pivotal role in this game for the Pirates, as she is every game, with her DD and Tab. Yeah, because it's just going to be better for her. And if for her to defeat them and to get these upperclassmen their first NCAA tournament victory, not only their first appearance in the game, to help them get their first victory, I think it's going to speak great of everything that she's meant for this team and the season that this team has had.
I want to touch base on the guard play. So not just Daisha, but Khadijah Simmons and also Tabitha Richardson-Smith. Aaron, how important is it going to be for the guards to step up in this big game?
It's crucial. As we know, Daisha Simmons, you know, defensive player of the year in the Big East. But Khadijah Simmons, she is the floor general of the team. As we all know, we've mentioned it plenty of times before. And Tabitha Richardson-Smith shoots lights out. You know, a little cold in the final game in the Big East tournament. First, you know, she's getting 31 points, getting high 20s. Then she comes off cold. You got to rely on Khadijah Simmons. She's been leading the team her whole career. Pride of Newark, I'll tell you. And you got to go with it.
George, Tabitha Richardson-Smith, only 6 points in the Big East championship game. Is there a cause of concern for her and her productivity heading into the NCAAs?
What I saw in that game, I was up there in Chicago covering it. And it was that Seton Hall was really contained to a half-court offense. What they can't afford to have is another game where they force 16 turnovers but only get 11 points off those turnovers.
Exactly.
And what Doug Bruno did was just simple. He didn't do anything crazy. He showed the nation how you stop the most explosive player in the conference. And all he did was have Santrice McGee get right in front of Tab, never turn her head around to the ball, and play face-guarding defense. Because that's what she did. She contained her, never gave her space to breathe, and it took her out of the game completely. And when DePaul got out to a 15-3 lead to start the game, there was no looking back for the Blue Demons. What you need for Tab is to not have another repeat game like that. They need to start pulling down defensive rebounds. They need to run the floor as well. They have all the experience. They have all the athleticism as well. And what this team gets with that, and what I'm looking at more is the matchup between Tony and Vivian. Right. Because Bazella said after the game himself that loss was on him. He failed to make adjustments, and that's what a coach's job is. When you're a leading scorer, your most explosive player, like I said, only has 6 points, that's on coaching because that cannot happen again. If they want to get past to the next round, they need to have all three play at the highest velocity possible because they can't recreate anything. You know what you'll get from Janae.
It's just like what they were all year. You know, they're a run-and-gun team, causing turnovers. They have to score off them. And it's exactly what Bazella wants them to do. They all bought into the system. We know that clearly from their record. And it's just going to be a battle. It's going to be a dogfight. And as Bazella even said after they found out they were playing Rutgers again, he said, yes, let's go down there, get our fan base there, and let's get revenge of last season.
This team never lacks the motivation and is just going to add to the recipe of success. All the experience, all the offensive power, that's what you want.
Well, I don't think they need much motivation as they will be taking on Rutgers at 6:30 Saturday night in Storrs, Connecticut. The winner will take on UConn. Well, I'd like to thank you for joining us this evening. It's really a special time for Seton Hall athletics in general, just having their women's basketball program in the NCAA tournament for the first time in 20 years. I'd like to thank George Bileschi and Aaron Ross for joining me this evening. I'm your host, David Heim. Have a good night.